أكبر الله أكبر الله أكبر الله
إن الحمد لله إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهدي الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له ونشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله صلى الله عليه وسلم أما بعد فقال عز وجل بعد أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم قل يا عباد الذي يسرفوا على أنفسهم لا تقنطوا من رحمة الله إن الله يغفر الذنوب جميعا إنه هو الغفور الرحيم وقال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم في حديث قدسي قال عز وجل إن رحمتي سبقت غضبي. Respected brothers and sisters, every Muslim desire in this life to have a place in Jannah. Everyone desires Jannah, paradise. And everyone fears Jahannam. As Muslim, our effort that we do in this life, the salat we pray, the zakat we give, the siyam, the fasting we do in Ramadan, and all the sadaqah that we give and we do in this life cannot earn us Jannah. Salat cannot give us Jannah. Zakat cannot give us Jannah. Hajj cannot give us Jannah. Jannah cannot be bought. No amount of a'mal, no amount of good deeds that one do cannot earn him Jannah. This does not only for the Muslims or for the ordinary believers, this is only also for the Anbiyas. Even our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, with all the effort and all the salat and all the good that he did in his life, cannot earn him Jannah. How do we know this? We know this by our holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. He was sitting with his companions, hadith in Sahih Muslim. And he says, oh my companions, do not ever think that your good deeds will earn you Jannah. At this moment, the companions were very baffled, very worried. After all the efforts they have made, then Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, one will only enter Jannah through the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then the companions asked him, so Prophet of Allah, even you? He says, yes, even me. No amount of good deeds will not make me enter Jannah. I cannot bargain with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and say, Allah, accept my good deeds, give me Jannah. Jannah is only through the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Jannah is a gift to the believers from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we can only earn it through the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The salat we pray, the zakat we give, The fasting we do, the good deeds we have done, those things are only a means to forgive our sins so that Allah will show us mercy and grant us Jannah. The ibadat that we do in Islam are meant for Allah's forgiveness. We must understand this. How much can you pay? What will you be able to give for everlasting life? How much can you pay for everlasting life? People are waiting for 5 and 10 years for one kidney. They're willing to pay any amount of price for one kidney. How much you're willing to pay for everlasting life? How much money do you have to pay to Allah? The value of Jannah we cannot imagine. So how can your salah give you Jannah? Any believer who thinks that because of my good deeds, Allah will give me Jannah, you have been deceived by Shaitan. You have been deceived by Shaitan. You must understand this, my dear brothers and sisters. Do not misunderstand what I am saying, that we should not do good deeds. It is a means for Allah to forgive us. That is why we should always and constantly be in the forgiveness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. As believer, the only key to Jannah is to do what Allah has told us to do. And if we make a mistake, we ask for forgiveness. And then on the day of Yawmul Qiyamah, Allah will show us mercy and give us Jannah. That's it. It is simple as that. We do our utmost in this life, what Allah tells us to do. And whenever we make a mistake and we commit a sin, we ask Allah's forgiveness. Every human being, every prophet went through the system. Our father Adam alayhi salam, he asked Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He says, Ya Rabb, you know, you created me. You honor me to be the first human being. You honor me with prophethood. You know that I will commit the sin. I will make this mistake. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says yes. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala taught Adam alayhi salam the dua that we all know. Rabbana zulamna anfusana. He said, oh Adam, recite this, I will forgive you. It's only a means for his forgiveness. It's only a means for his forgiveness. Yusha bin Nun, Yunus alayhi salam, in the stomach of the wheel. La ilaha illa anta subhanaka inni kuntu. Our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he gave us dua also. Rabbana atina fi dunya hasana wa fil akhirati hasana wa qina adhab an-nar. This was the most constant dua of our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Give us the good in this life, the good of the hereafter, and save us from Jahannam. We cannot. Our Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was a man who gave hope in the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. As the ayat I have quoted, قُلْ يَا عِبَادِيَ الَّذِينَ أَسْرَفُوا عَلَىٰ أَنفُسِهِمْ لَا تَقْنَطُوا مِنْ رَحْمَةِ اللَّهِ. O you who have transgressed against your soul, لَا تَقْنَطُوا مِنْ رَحْمَةِ. Do not give up in the hope of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. إِنَّ اللَّهَ يَغْفِرُ ذُنُوبَ جَمِيعًا. That Allah, it is the one who forgives all sins. إِنَّهُ هُوَ الْغَفُورُ الرَّحِيمُ. He is most forgiving, most compassionate. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in 114 surah in Quran, every surah begins with the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Bismillahirrahmanirrahim, except chapter 9. Allah begins with His mercy. Allah introduced Himself by His mercy. Every believer, it is important to give hope in the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Many a times we kill the hope in people. Sometimes we kill the hope in the heart of our children because we already condemned towards Jahannam. They might not be making salat. They might not be coming to the masjid. So we give up hope on them. That's it. All of us know the story of the man. The famous hadith. The man who killed 99 persons. So he decided to make amends. This man now, after killing 99 men, he wants to know if Allah will show him mercy. So he goes to the abid and he asks the abid, the servant of Allah, the worshipper, do you think I have killed, he confessed, I have killed 99 men. Do you think there is any hope that Allah will forgive me? This worshipper said, no, there is no way Allah will forgive me. He killed him, completed number 100 men. That's it, finish him. So he went to the faqih, to the learned men. And he says, do you think I have killed 100 men? I don't know if he answered out of fear or out of wisdom. He said, do you think that Allah will have any mercy on me? Allah will show me any mercy? So this learned scholar says, yes. Do not ever give up in the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This hadith is not about the man who killed 99 men. This hadith is about the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It exemplifies how much hope we should give people and how magnitude is the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Very important. And all of us know this story. The scholar said, travel. And as he was traveling, he said, go to this land. And if you want to change your life, you will see people who don't know you. In this village, people know you as a murderer. Go to this place and you will live a good, pious life and you will... That's it. People will not know your crime. So as he was traveling to this land, he died. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent two angels. As usual, when someone dies, there's the angel of rahmah and the angel of punishment. So they came, both of them came, and the angel of mercy said, you know what, I should take this man because he was going towards changing his life. At least he has an intention, a niyyah of changing his life. The angel of punishment says, no. So then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala inspire them and tell them, look, this is the judgment. If this man is closest to the land where he left, then the angel of punishment, you take him. But if this man is closer to the distance where he was going to change his life, then the angel of mercy, you take him. Guess what happened? Was he closer to mercy? No. He was closer to the land where he left. So the angel took him. The angel of punishment was supposed to take his life. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants to show His mercy. This hadith shows the magnitude of Allah's mercy. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala causes the earth to shrink from the distance to where he was going, from to the distance where he was coming from. So the angel of mercy took his life. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on the day of Yawmul Qiyamah, there will be one man There will be this believer who, because of some reason, he has to go to Jahannam. And as he was going towards Jahannam, the fire receded from him. The fire went away from him. The fire refused to burn this man. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, "Ya Nar, what is the matter with you? O fire, what is the matter with you?" He says, "Ya Rab," Jahannam addressing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says, "Ya Rab, this servant of yours, on walking towards Jahannam, towards me, he was seeking refuge in you from me. Ya Rab, he had hope in your mercy, even though you sentenced him towards Jahannam. Even though you sent him towards Jahannam, this man walking towards Jahannam, Ya Rab, he had hope in your mercy." Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has told this man, "I forgive you," and Allah grant him Jannah. It is important in this life that every believer should be given hope. No matter what your sin are, no matter what crime you have committed in this life, until Allah take your life, until Malakul Maut come to take your life, we should have that great hope in the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We should all hold on to that hope that Allah will forgive me. And every believer should give people hope. We should not write off people on the surface of the earth. No matter what crime they have committed, it is very important. There are many ahadith, and there are many Quranic ayahs, verses of Quran where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about his mercy. And the hadith I have quoted, "Inna rahmati sabaqat ghadabi," that my rahmah, my mercy, prevail over my punishment. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala divide his mercy into 100 parts. And only one part out of 100 parts, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala only descend from the time of creation of Adam alayhi salam until the last man to come to live. That one part of mercy is sustaining the entire creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The entire human race is eating and drinking based on that one part of the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Imagine that. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, 99 part of that mercy remaining are for those people who will come on the day of Yawmul Qiyamah with sins, so that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala can show his mercy upon them. Believing brothers and sisters, it is very important. Our Nabi, our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, rahmatulil alameen, mercy to all mankind, mercy even towards his enemies. When Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was chased out of Makkah, the Quraysh, they put a big number on his head. He was the most wanted man. He was the most wanted man. It is said there was approximately 200 men, skilled archers, skilled hunters, people who knows tracking, who can smell the air and know where you are. 200 men took off in the desert to look for him. There was one man. His name was Suraqa. He was the only man who found Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Suraqa. As he was approaching Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam prayed to Allah, make a dua. The horse feet sunk in the sand, cannot move. He begged Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He said, "Oh Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, relieve me, relieve my horse." Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam prayed, Allah relieved the horse. Second time, same thing happened. Third time, same thing happened. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam made a prediction at this moment, one of the mu'jiza, one of the miracles of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, happened in this moment. He says, "Oh Suraqah, what will you do now?" He said, "Oh Muhammad, I will go back to Quraysh and I will not even tell them if I see you. I will deny I see you." He said, no, I'm not talking about that. I am talking about what will you do, O Suraqah, when the bracelet of Al-Kisra will be put into your hand?" Suraqah says, "What? This has to be a madman. He is barely struggling with a few followers, and he is telling me that I will be wearing the bracelet of Kisra, the emperor of the Persian Empire, the greatest empire at that time. How can I able to wear the bracelet of the great king Kisra?" In the time of Umar radiallahu anhu, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the qissa, the gist, is that he gave this man hope. Later on, he accepted Islam. In the time of Umar radiallahu anhu, when they conquered the Persian Empire, all the wealth came to Medina. Umar radiallahu anhu was going through the bounties, and he saw there was a box. And he opened the box and he saw the bracelet of Kisra, the emperor. He called Suraqah. He says, "Come." He says, "This is the prediction and the prophecy of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that you shall be given the bracelet of Al-Kisra." He gave this man hope. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, this man was chasing. He was behind the Prophet of Allah not to hear this story. He was behind the Prophet of Allah to kill him, to take his head back to Quraysh to get the price, the most wanted man. So Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam even give hope to his enemies. What about we as Muslims? How much hope should we have and how much hope should we give other people? Today we look at people who are not doing what we are doing in a negative way. People might not be praying their salat, they might not be coming to the masjid. But wallahi, we need to give them hope. Because Allah give us hope. Very important. لا تقنطوا من رحمة الله. Do not give up on the mercy of Allah. Allah says in the Quran, never take away hope from people's hearts. Because you're going against Allah. You're going against one of the attributes of Allah, the most merciful. You are taking away this man's hope of mercy. When you kill his hope that he's a believer, he might be committing sin. But then again, you're saying, you know what? You're going to Jahannam. You're going to Jahannam. That's it. How many times do we tell people that? Many times. Wallahi, my dear brothers and sisters, it's very important that as Muslim, we die in two states. We die in two states. One is the fear of Allah. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, more in the mercy of Allah. So you die between the two things. That you fear that whatever sin you committed, and you hope that Allah will overlook your sins and forgive you and grant you Jannah. It is very important that as believers we always seek the forgiveness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because as I said in the beginning of the khutbah, no amount of amal, no amount of amal will give us Jannah. None. A man can spend his entire life worshipping Allah. No work, no job, no business. No amount of ibadat can give us Jannah. None. Our ibadat are means of forgiveness. Bas. Our ibadat are a means of forgiveness for our sins. Bas. Cannot give us Jannah. Wallahi, my dear brothers and sisters, the description of Jannah, even though Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says that no eyes has ever seen, no heart cannot comprehend, no mind cannot understand. Imam Al-Qayyim Al-Jawziyyah rahimahumullah wrote in a beautiful book. He says, wallahi, if you think about the earth and the streets of Jannah, the streets and the earth of Jannah is made up of musk and saffron. Imam Al-Qayyim Al-Jawzi says, wallahi, if I have to be homeless in Jannah, I want to enter Jannah. Even though Allah does not give me a palace, I want to be in Jannah. He says, when you think about the fruits and the trees of Jannah, the shade of one tree, a rider will ride his horse for 100 years, he will still underbe the shade. When you think about the roof of Jannah, what is the roof of Jannah? The roof of Jannah, your eyes have not seen such a decoration, because the roof of Jannah is taht al-arsh Allah. The roof of Jannah is beneath the arsh of Allah. Imam Al-Qayyim Jazza says that such decoration you have never seen. You're talking about chandeliers and paintings. It will not compare what is there in Jannah, the roof of Jannah. When you think about the rivers of Jannah, pure milk, no expiration date. Pure milk, no expiration date. Pure honey, you will never get tired of drinking it. Pure water, it will quench your thirst. Pure wine that will not intoxicate you. And you will not have hangovers the next day. When you think about the palaces of Jannah, it says a man will walk in his palace for 100 years and he will still be in his own palace. Can you imagine that? That is why Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, no eyes has ever seen and no mind cannot comprehend what is Jannah. There is no price you cannot pay for Jannah. Jannah is a gift from Allah that no money cannot buy. And the only two things that we have to do is whatever Allah commands us, we do. And whenever we make a mistake, we ask forgiveness. Bas. Whatever Allah commands, we try our utmost. And whenever we cannot or we made a mistake, we ask forgiveness. It is only through the mercy one will enter into Jannah. No amal, nothing. This goes for every Muslim, male and female. This even goes to the prophets and the ambiyas and the righteous people. No amount of ibadah can give us Jannah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant all of us an entrance into Jannah, inshallah. May Allah give us Jannatul Firdaus and our children and our family and all of us, inshallah. Aquli qawli hadha wa astaghfirullah li wa lakum fastaghfiruhu innahu huwal ghafurur rahim. الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على سيدنا مولانا محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما اللهم صل على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما صليت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم إنك حميد مجيد وبارك على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما باركت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم إنك حميد مجيد إن الله يأمر بالعدل والإحسان وإيتاء ذي القربى وينهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر والبغي يعظكم لعلكم تذكرون اذكروا الله يذكركم ولذكر الله أكبر أقيم الصلاة